crews brought in loads of old, wet, half-drowned people. They were dirty. Some terribly sick. All of them lonely, frightened. Others were black and brown and different from the majority of the club members. The beautiful new club suddenly became messy and cluttered. A special committee saw to it that a shower house was immediately built outside and down the road from the club, so victims of shipwreck could get cleaned up before coming inside the nice building. At the next meeting, there were strong words and angry feelings, which resulted in a division among the members. Most of the people wanted to stop the club's life-saving activities and all involvement with shipwreck victims. As they put it, it's just too unpleasant. It's a hindrance to our social life. It's really opening doors to folks who are not our kind. As you'd expect, some still insisted on saving lives. That this was their primary objective. That their only reason for existence was ministering to anyone needing help, regardless of the club's beauty or size or decorations. They were voted down. And they were told that they wanted to save the lives of various kinds of people who were shipwrecked in those waters. They could begin their own life-saving station down the coast, which they did. As years passed, the new station experienced the same old changes. It evolved into yet another club, and yet another life-saving station was begun elsewhere. History continued to repeat itself, and if you visit the coastline today, you'll find a large number of inclusive, impressive clubs along there, owned and operated by slick professionals who have lost all involvement with the saving and rescuing of lives. Shipwrecks still occur in those waters, but now most of the victims were not saved. Every day, they drowned at sea, and so few seemed to care. So very few. Remember Gabriel's question? Remember it, don't you? Have you made other plans? If those 21st century people grow weary of obeying your commission, remember the answer? No. I have no other plan. The Great Commission. Or there is no other plan. Now I close with a question. Were you engaged in your life in obeying the Great Commission? In case you wonder about how you would answer, can you name a disciple as a result of your influencing your life, reaching out, speaking, caring, rescuing, loving those who are lost?
Don't do that.
Please go to me. Sit very quietly. Yeah, but I'm not going to pause and answer. Think about it. What you have just heard.
Yeah, but luckily
the question is really not how much of Matthew have we gone through.
Yep.
But whether how much of Matthew has gone through us.
Yeah, but I was a little close.
Jesus really meant it when he said, go, make disciples.
Well, you know, the limit here is actually 30.